Okay, now we'll start the session. So good evening, doctors. I'm Gaurav Desai. I'm the marketing head for Sonoscape India. I welcome all of you to this ultrasound webinar. Today, our topic is related to breast imaging. I'd like to welcome our guest speakers, Dr. Janki and Dr. Rupa. Thank you so much, ma'ams, for being a part of this webinar. At the same time, I'd like to welcome Dr. Balachandran and Dr. Amal Anthony also, as they will be the moderating both the sessions. So without taking much of time, I will like to hand over the session to Dr. Balachandran. Thank you so much.
Good evening, everybody. On behalf of Crest Kochi and IRA Kochi and Sonoscape team, I welcome you all for this webinar of the day. We have been conducting webinars regularly, and today the topic is breast imaging. For the breast imaging, we have great faculties like Janagi Dharmarajan and Ruba Ranganathan. We have two topics for the day. One is appropriateness in breast imaging, choose the right modality by Dr. Ruba Ranganathan. And the second is pregnancy-associated breast diseases. The first one will be covered by Ruba Ranganathan. Dr. Ruba is the lead consultant in breast imaging and interventions at Department of Diagnostics and Interventional Radiology, Kaveri Medical Center and Hospitals, Coimbatore. She has vast experience in the field of breast imaging, has conducted a lot of lectures, workshops in India and abroad. I'm sure you will be enjoying the sessions. I hand it over to Dr. Ruba to continue the session. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind introduction. At the outset, I would like to thank IRA Kochi, Crest Kochi, and Sonoscape for conducting this session. Can you see the screen now?
Yes, ma'am, we can see.
Okay. The first topic for today is appropriateness in breast imaging. I'm sure all of you in your clinical practice would have faced a situation of dilemma of what to ask for that particular patient first. Are we doing the right choice of investigation for the particular clinical scenario? If I'm able to give an answer or to clear your doubts at the end of the session, I would have achieved something. Let's see. There are various modalities in breast imaging, starting from mammogram, which includes two-dimensional imaging and also digital breast tomosynthesis, ultrasound, which has got 3D Doppler and elastography, MRI, and nuclear studies, which include bone scan and PET CT. There are recent additions, which also include thermography, positron emission mammography, and PET MRI, and so on and so forth. And every day, we have some additions for the modalities that can be used in breast imaging. Before we dive into the topic, let's see some clinical situations. So I'm going to throw you some questions. Please note down the answers, and let's see what is the right answer at the end. The first clinical scenario is a 45-year-old lady with breast lump. She's scared of pain and radiation from mammogram. What would you advise her? Ultrasound, MRI, or will you persist her to get mammogram only? The next situation, this is a 33-year-old lady. She's coming and asking you for a screening mammogram. She's so scared of breast cancer because her mother died at the age of 57 due to breast cancer a month ago. What would you advise her? Mammogram? Considering her age, will you perform screening ultrasound? Oh, she's under high risk. Will you do an MRI or will you not do any imaging? The third situation is a 24-year-old lady with diffuse breast pain. She had undergone ultrasound, which was normal, reported elsewhere. Her GP now refers her to you for a mammogram. What would you advise her? Mammogram? Young patient, so no radiation, suggest MRI, or will you not do any further imaging? The next clinical scenario is a 54-year-old lady with suspicious finding on mammogram and ultrasound. She was referred to you because you work in a tertiary care center for additional imaging. What would you advise her? You work in a higher center, so will you do MRI for her? Will you not do an MRI for her? Or will you suggest a biopsy? The last situation, clinical scenario is a 43-year-old lady with spiculated mass on mammogram and the biopsy done elsewhere showed fibrocystic disease. Your pathologist have reviewed the blocks and they said it's fibrocystic disease. Now the surgery hospital sends her. What would you advise her? Will you just reassure her because your pathologist also said it's fibrocystic disease, or would you suggest an MRI because she already had a mammogram done? Or will you re-biopsy this lesion? So as a radiologist in breast imaging, we not only have to understand the advantage, but also the limitation of each modality that we use. Not only we diagnose and do perform procedures, but we also play a key role in staging and follow-up. And above all, it's almost very special to breast imaging that it is our responsibility to confirm the RAD-PATH concordance. We also should be aware that all the modalities that we use in breast imaging are complementary to each other and not competitive. And we have to be a specialty radiologist rather than a modality radiologist. This is because, for example, if you're performing an MRI, it is not enough if you just go through the mammogram reports. You should be able to read the mammogram images yourself. And if in case you find an additional finding on a mammogram, you also have to do an ultrasound yourself. The second look ultrasound should be done by you. So you have to be well versed across the modalities, and you have to be a specialty radiologist having a holistic idea about the breast imaging and not just that modality that you're reporting. And you also have to be a clinical radiologist. A lot of time we need to talk to the patient, know what her problem is, rather than just sitting in a dark room and reporting mammograms. So we have to be a clinical radiologist rather than a dark room radiologist. First, let's just clear about the scare about the radiation. One mammogram is equivalent to 7 weeks of background radiation. And a lethal dose, for to get a lethal dose, you have to undergo 12,500 mammograms. And that's a lot, right? So mammogram cannot kill a woman, but breast cancer can. So you have to be clear about the radiation, the risks of radiation that you are dealing with whenever the patient or your clinical colleagues ask about it. Broadly, the breast imaging is divided into a screening setup and a diagnostic setup. Let's see one by one. In a screening scenario, the major information that we need to know about a patient to choose the right modality is to know the age of the patient and also her risk stratification. So how do we do the risk stratification? We need to know the age, race, menstrual history, age at the time of first childbirth, history of radiation to chest at younger age. Does she have a personal history of breast cancer and a more detailed history of the family history of breast and ovarian cancer? It's not just enough if your family history is yes or no. We need to know who was the one who suffered in the family and what type of cancer at what age. All those information is very crucial to decide on her screening recommendation. And we also have to know about the history of breast biopsy. There may be some high-risk lesions or pre-malignant lesions for which she must have undergone a breast biopsy. So we need to know all those information before we recommend a screening for her. There are a lot of screening risk stratification models that are available. Some of them are freely available in the net. All we have to do is feed those clinical information or the history information that we have obtained from the patient, and it calculates the risk for you. So it's broadly age. In general, we start screening after 40 years of age for a low risk or a general population. While there are no specific upper limit like when to stop screening, as long as her life expectancy is at least for more than 5 years, we can continue to do screening. And risk stratification is basically divided into three categories. Low is less than 15%, intermediate is 15 to 20%, and high is more than 20%. So roughly, the low risk group come under with a history of no personal or family history of risk, and she has no premalignant or high risk lesions. Intermediate group of patients are those who have personal history of breast cancer and have few high risk lesions, which include ADH, which is atypical ductal hyperplasia, and lobular carcinoma in situ. High risk groups are those who fall under genetic risk, the BRCA and other mutations, and the family history of the relatives when they are young, the BRCA positive, the history of chest wall radiation when they are 10 to 13 years. So when do we start screening? Low risk group when they are above 40 years, family history when they are 10 years before the age of first degree relative. So it does not mean that if you have all of them are genetic carriers. So we roughly start the screening 10 years before the age of first degree relative, and mammogram is usually not performed before 30 years of age, both for intermediate and for high risk lesions, based on the fact that we don't expose the young breast to radiation, and also younger breasts are much more denser, and mammogram may not give an useful information just by performing it. Intermediate risk due to breast lesions are whenever you diagnose that the lady is having such high risk lesions, and then you from that age we start her for an annual mammogram. High risk group we start at the age of 25 till 30 years. We do only annual breast MRI, and the annual mammogram is started only after her 30 years of age, and we continue to do annual MRI and annual mammogram for high risk group of patients. So what is the modality that we do? This is what we saw was the age at the time we have to start screening, and what is the modality that we have to do is mammogram is the modality of choice for low risk groups, and ultrasound is usually not performed, and MRI is definitely not indicated in low risk group. So that we have to remember, because though MRI is a very good investigation to find invasive cancers, we need to know that it is a lot more sensitive. So we will end up performing unnecessary biopsies on them. So MRI is not indicated in the low risk group. When it comes to intermediate group, again, mammogram is the modality of choice, and supplemental ultrasound is recommended, especially for patients with dense breast. And again, MRI is not indicated except for certain cases where we decide on case-to-case basis. On a high risk, again, mammogram is the modality of choice. Ultrasound can be considered if MRI is not tolerated or contraindicated for that patient. And MRI is also the standard of care. So we perform both mammogram and MRI for high risk group. How frequent is our next question? The answer is annual. So every year is what is the recommendation. So summarize, for low risk, more than 40 years, we do mammogram. Intermediate risk, annual mammogram from the time of diagnosis of high risk lesions or 10 years before the family history. Mammogram is the usual modality. Some cases we may do MRI too. High risk cases, we start the screening with MRI at 25 years of age and mammogram at 30 years of age. And we perform both annual mammogram and MRI for high risk patients. So from screening, we move on to the second group of patients that we deal with, which is the diagnostic imaging. So diagnostic imaging is done for women who come with a specific clinical symptom, which have to be answered with our imaging. And the most common clinical symptom being mass, pain, and nipple discharge. When it comes to diagnostic group of patients, we categorize patients based on their age, which is less than 30, 30 to 40, or more than 40. For more than 40, mammogram, 30 to 40 is ultrasound or mammogram based on the clinical situation. Less than 30, we start with ultrasound. So this is the basic protocol that we follow for diagnostic imaging group. So how do we work up a breast mass? It is the most common symptom that we encounter in our clinical practice. Many a times on clinical examination, our surgical colleagues will not be able to differentiate whether it is a solid mass or a cystic mass. And due to inconsistent clinical examination findings, imaging is very important. And whenever a lady presents with a breast mass, the diagnosis can be right from normal breast tissue to a benign lesion to cancer. And every time we need to insist to our clinical colleagues that imaging has to be done prior to biopsy, not after the biopsy, because sometimes post-biopsy changes can interfere with our imaging interpretation. And we also have to remember that whenever a lady presents with a breast mass, when we do both mammogram and ultrasound, the negative predictive value is close to 100%. So imaging is very important in evaluation of a breast mass. So how do we approach? I already said when they are more than 40, we will perform a mammogram. So whenever you do a mammogram, these are the possibilities that we can get. So she may present with a breast lump, but you may not see anything. It can be a normal mammogram, or we call it as a negative mammogram. So if you get a negative mammogram, the next step is to perform an ultrasound. So we have to do a targeted ultrasound, talk to the patient where she feels the mass, and do a targeted ultrasound to make sure that what she feels may be a normal breast tissue, or we are finding something abnormal in that. Because in case of a dense breast, sometimes even with tomosynthesis, it may be difficult to locate the mass. So we have to perform a targeted ultrasound when we have a negative mammogram. What if we have a definitely benign lesion? So for example, it can be a lipoma, it can be a hematoma. There is no need to perform ultrasound on them. We know short 100% that they are benign. They are do not touch lesions. We know that 100% there is no risk for malignancy in this patient. So we don't need to perform an ultrasound to reconfirm a benign finding. We can be confident enough to stop with the mammogram. If we find a probably benign, for example, when she is presenting with the mass, it may be a non-calcified mass with circumscribed margins. So we need to also perform an ultrasound to confirm that it is definitely has a circumscribed margin, and if so, recommend for a 6-month follow-up. We may have a BI-RADS 4 or BI-RADS 5, which means it can be a suspicious finding or a highly suggestive of a cancer. We will still do an ultrasound for two reasons. If that lesion can be seen on ultrasound, we can biopsy it using that modality, which is much more comfortable both for us and also for the patient. And also we will have an opportunity to screen the axilla. So axillary nodes are best evaluated with ultrasound. So whenever we have even a typical spiculated mass with pleomorphic microcalcification in a fatty breast, we know that we are dealing with malignancy. We will still perform an ultrasound. One is to use the modality to target the biopsy, and second is to look for axillary lymph nodes. What do we do with the lady who is less than 30? So if it's normal and negative, we know where she feels a lump, we can do a targeted ultrasound. If it is a normal breast tissue is what she feels, no further imaging is required. For example, if you're seeing a simple cyst, again, no further imaging is required. If you find a probably benign lesion, you're going to follow her up in ultrasound. But if you have a suspicious imaging or a feature which you are worried about a cancer, we can perform the biopsy. And if you're very sure that you're dealing with the cancer, we can perform the mammogram as well in the same sitting, or else you can wait for the biopsy report and then perform. Remember, age is not a problem. Whatever age she is, if she is having a cancer, mammogram can be done. It's a very different situation from screening. You're dealing with a lady who already has come for a complaint and you're thinking in terms of a cancer. And so mammogram can be performed even though she is less than 30 years. In an age group between 30 to 40, you have the freedom of choosing between these two modalities based on the clinical suspicion. You can start with ultrasound and you can start with mammogram, and you follow the same flowchart based on the findings that you get in this group of patients. What is the role of MR? There is no role for MRI in the initial evaluation. MRI can be performed after confirmation of malignancy to assess the local extent and staging. Remember, we don't start with the MRI. We perform the biopsy for suspicious lesion, and once it's proved, you may do it based on the clinical need. To summarize, remember, you have to perform imaging prior to biopsy, and you have to have a correlation between clinical finding and imaging. And if it's more than 40, start with mammogram. Less than 30, start with ultrasound. 30 to 40, choose between ultrasound and mammogram based on the clinical suspicion. But remember this important information: any highly suspicious breast mass detected by imaging should be biopsied irrespective of the palpable finding. The surgeon may say, no, it's definitely a mobile lesion, I think it's a fibroadenoma. But if you don't think as a fibroadenoma on benign, on your imaging, do a biopsy. And if you have a highly suspicious breast mass detected by palpation, should be biopsied, irrespective of the imaging finding. You may say that, I think it's, I see just a normal glandular parenchyma, but the surgeon feels it's a hard lump. We have to biopsy. Our threshold of biopsy should be low. We cannot leave a doubt that whether it could be a cancer or it's not a cancer. If the imaging or the clinical finding is suggestive of malignancy, please go ahead and biopsy that abnormality. Moving on to the second most common symptom, which is a breast pain. Again, we need more clinical information on the nature of the pain to decide on the imaging. The incidence of cancer for women who present with isolated breast pain is only 0 to 3%. Some studies even had said there's no increased or even a decreased risk for that particular patient. So whenever a patient comes with pain, we don't first possibility as malignancy. The possibility is very, very low. The possibility that it could be a cancer is very low in your list. And even for patients who are presenting with significant pain, benign findings are the most common cause. So how do you assess them? If it is a typical cyclical premenstrual pain, which is relieved after menstruation, if it's diffuse, unilateral or bilateral, we call them as insignificant pain. And there is no indication for imaging, irrespective of the age, provided she has her proper screening done every year if she is more than 40. If it is a focal, persistent, non-cyclical pain, it is significant. So we decide on, we'll go ahead and the modality of imaging based on the age. Again, if it's more than 40, you're going to do mammo, 30 to 40, you can do both. Less than 30 is we start with ultrasound. What is the role of MRI? There's definitely no role for MRI for women who's presenting with isolated breast pain. Remember, also, when you perform an imaging, the negative predictive value is close to 100%. Sometimes a targeted ultrasound for significant focal pain can potentially identify treatable causes of breast pain like cysts, where you can put in a needle, aspirate, and give her a pain relief. We'll move on to the third most common symptom, with this nipple discharge. Again, it needs much more clinical information. And we also have to know that cytology being positive and cytology being negative doesn't mean anything. So we don't regularly perform cytology for all women who is presenting with nipple discharge. Incidence of malignancy in isolated nipple discharge is 6.1% versus a nipple discharge along with the mass, which is very, very high, which is around 61.5%. So when do you decide that nipple discharge can be ignored, which is physiological, is when it have a non-spontaneous nipple discharge, when it's bilateral, when it's multiporous, when the color of the discharge is white, green or yellow. No imaging is required for these physiological discharge, irrespective of the age, provided the lady is under the regular screening protocol. Whenever we have a spontaneous unilateral single porous discharge, we call it as pathological. Also, the color of the discharge would be serous or serosanguinous. And then we have to perform imaging because it is pathological discharge. We may find something within her breast. And the modality is again based on the age. So it is the same thing. More than 40 is going to be mammo, less than 30 is ultrasound. In between, you can do both the modalities or any modalities to start with. What about ductogram? I don't think currently we regularly, none of us regularly perform ductogram because it's an invasive procedure. A lot of times we have failure to cannulate the pathological duct, and we can have extravasation, we can have wrong cannulation. Even if we have a successful cannulation, many a times we won't be able to differentiate between a benign and malignant because it just shows a cutoff sign. So what is happening after that, we have no clue. And sometimes we can also have a contrast reaction. So we had stopped performing ductogram as we have much more non-invasive way of looking at ducts. What is the role of MRI in pathological nipple discharge? It is very promising. It has a potential role to identify the cause of pathological discharge, especially when we have negative conventional imaging. We can also perform the MR ductography, which is a heavily T2-weighted image, wherein we can get a ductogram-like image, and we also can perform a contrast MRI and identify the little enhancing lesion, which is the cause of the pathological nipple discharge. So the MRI definitely has a role in nipple discharge evaluation, especially when the conventional imaging are negative. Also, performing MRI is important in this difficult clinical situation because many a times when we don't find a cause, surgeon goes and blindly do an adduct excision, which happens from 3 centimeters from the nipple. But up to 20%, that is 1 in 5 times, the cause can be beyond 3 centimeters. And there is a possibility in every 1 in 5 such cases that we will be totally missing the lesion and we would say that it is a normal duct. So MRI is definitely a promising tool in this situation. So we saw the screening, we saw the diagnosis. Now we would see certain situations where which modality will be useful for staging and also for the follow-up. Stage 1 breast cancer is what? T1N0. T1 is when the tumor is less than 2 centimeters and N0 stands for no clinically abnormal or radiologically abnormal lymph nodes. So what do? We don't need to stage that patient, provided if she's asymptomatic with a bone scan or a PET CT or a CT body or an MRI brain. Evaluation of staging is required only if she presents with focal symptoms. Surveillance after the surgery, mammogram is the modality for surveillance with or without MRI based on which category of risk she follows up. As long as she is asymptomatic, no metastatic workup is necessary for stage 1 breast cancer. What about locally advanced breast cancer, which is LABC? We give neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy is something that we give chemotherapy before the surgery. Why do we do that? To decrease the tumor burden and also to have an in vivo assessment of the tumor response. Complete response gives the women a longer disease-free survival, and hence imaging is very important to assess the treatment response. Many a time, only clinical examination will not be able to tell whether she responded or not. So how do we do that? There are 3 categories that we may have to assess in a locally advanced breast cancer. 1 is a primary tumor per se. 2 is the axilla. And 3, because she is locally advanced, we also have to do metastatic workup. And how do we do? As long as the primary tumor is concerned, MRI is definitely superior than mammo and ultrasound. Response. Mammo and ultrasound are equally good in the pre-neoadjuvant to assess the extent of the tumor, pre-neoadjuvant too. When it comes to axilla, it is always, always ultrasound, whether it is a pre-treatment evaluation or to assess the post-treatment response, still ultrasound is the best modality to assess the axillary lymph nodes. To metastatic workup, PET CT can be done or should be done in a locally advanced. If there is availability of PET CT, then bone scan with CT thorax and abdomen and pelvis is an equally good alternative to assess the metastatic load. Finally, I'm not going to touch much because the next key is going to be on this. When it comes to imaging in pregnancy and lactation, ultrasound is the first modality of choice. However, remember, if the lady has got a cancer, mammogram is definitely not a contraindication and it can be performed to assess the lesion. MRI is usually not done in pregnancy because we don't perform MRI breast as a non-contrast imaging. We rely mostly on the enhancement characteristics and kinetics. So contrast cannot be given during pregnancy. So it is usually not done in pregnancy but can be done during lactation. If a lady is under high risk, she can continue to undergo mammogram during her pregnancy and lactation period. So having seen right from the screening to diagnosis to stage and to some special situations, now let's go back and check our answers. So the first scenario, she is scared of radiation, but she's 45 years. So what will need lady above 45, it's going to be persist her to get mammogram only. There is no role for ultrasound. There is no role for MRI. Screening is with the breast lump. She is 45 years. So the initial assessment has to be done only mammogram. So this is a 33-year-old lady with some. Her mother dies of 57 years old. So what will you do now? She's 57. So even if you calculate her 10 years prior to 7, we can start at the age of 40. So at the moment is not a significant pain. Already she has got her ultrasound done. Significant pain, if her ultrasound is normal, we further imaging. So the answer is no further imaging for this. This 54-year-old lady with suspicious finding. So she already has got a suspicious finding. So the next step is not an MRI. It's not an answer for a lesion. The next step is actually we should perform a biopsy and not an MRI. If that lesion turns out to be, can do an MRI to assess the extent of the lesion, not before that. The last clinical situation is she already has got a speculated mass, the pathology, fibrocystic disease, and the surgeon sends you. So what will we do? We will have to do a rebiopsy because a speculated mass, the chance of malignancy is very high. We have to say that this is a rad path discordant finding, and we will rebiopsy this case to make sure that the speculated mass is targeted by imaging. A blind biopsy is done during the procedure, and the biopsy is not done for the objective coverage of the disease. It will not be found in the speculated mass, but we will do a rebiopsy in the country. So, to summarize, in screening, mammography is done and it should be done for all the groups, MRI for high-risk and select intermediate. Ultrasound is consistently seen dense breast. In diagnostic, remember this cutoff, more than 40, it is always mammogram. Less than 30, start with ultrasound. 30 to 40, you can do, start with either of these investigations based on the clinical suspicion and go about with further imaging based on the finding. What is the role of MRI in diagnostic workup? It is not the modality of choice for initial, can be used for further workup of pathologically proven cancer. However, it has a promising role in pathological nipple discharge when conventional modalities are negative. Mammogram can be done for any age, pregnancy or lactation if we are dealing with cancer. It is definitely not a contraindication for younger patient or pregnant patient or breastfeeding patient. It can be done because it's indicated and we have to see what is happening, what is a cancer extent is. For a stage one breast cancer, no metastatic workup is required if the patient is asymptomatic. And in a locally advanced breast cancer, MRI is the best modality to assess the treatment response in neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And ultrasound is still the best modality to assess both pre-treatment evaluation and post-treatment response of the axillary nodes. PET CT is used for metastatic workup. If your center is not having a PET CT, having a CT body, which is thorax, abdomen, and pelvis with bone scan is a very good and an equally good alternative. Apart from imaging, don't forget to talk to the patient. Many a time, that clinical information is going to clinch your diagnosis. And always, always correlate your clinical finding and imaging finding. Insist your surgical colleague to perform biopsy after imaging, and our job does not stop with biopsy or imaging. It is our responsibility to see whether the pathology report is in line with what we think. If not, inform the person who's treating the patient that, look, this looks very suspicious for me and the pathology is not the same. So we both are not concordant. Let's repeat the image. Or let us repeat the biopsy or at least do an excision biopsy to prove or disprove that what we are thinking is right. Every time, whenever during our clinical practice, if we have a dilemma, please remember all these protocols and guide the patient with the proper imaging modality. Thank you.
Thank you, Rupa, madam, for the wonderful presentation. We have a few questions. Can fibroadenosis disease be commented on ultrasound?
No, we don't use fibrocystic disease or fibroadenosis on imaging. It is actually a histopathological diagnosis. See, report whether you are seeing a solid mass and categorize the mass based on the BI-RADS or report it as cyst. We don't use fibrocystic breast disease or fibroadenosis on imaging. It's a pathological term.
Thank you, ma'am. What would be the BI-RADS classification of a simple cyst, a fibroadenoma, and fibrocystic change?
As I said, we don't use fibrocystic disease and it doesn't come in the BI-RADS. A simple cyst is a BI-RADS 2. she can go for a regular screening protocol based on the age. If she is younger patient, there is no more follow-up imaging or intervention is needed. And if the simple cyst is symptomatic for her and we want to put in a needle, even then we will report it as BI-RADS 2 and we will say aspiration can be done for symptomatic relief. Fibroadenoma, based on the imaging feature, we can categorize as 2, 3 or 4. For example, if the fibroadenoma shows a typical popcorn calcification, it's a typically involuted fibroadenoma, you're going to call it as 2. If the fibroadenoma appears as a solid oval-shaped lesion with circumscribed margin and you are seeing that for the first time, we are going to report it as 3 and ask for a follow-up after 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. So the follow-up is basically 0, 6, 12, 24 for a BI-RADS 3 lesion. Sometimes fibroadenoma can also have different margins with an overlap of malignancy. So in those cases, with imaging, we won't be able to differentiate that this could be a fibroadenoma or it is a malignancy. In that case, we will ask for a biopsy and prove that it is a fibroadenoma. So based on the imaging findings, it can be categorized as 2, 3 or 4.
Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot for the wonderful presentation. Now I hand it over to Mr. Gaurav.
Thank you, Dr. Balachandran. Thank you, ma'am, for such a nice presentation. Now, audience, I'll just take few minutes of you to just take you through the new technology what Sonoscape has launched. Artificial intelligence, as we all have heard, Sonoscape is an organization. What we can see that what to expect when AI meets ultrasound. So in this, need to know a bit about what exactly is there in artificial intelligence. So artificial intelligence contains machine language and deep learning, where to a machine we give lot much of a data so that machine can actually read like a human brain. So this is what is basically artificial intelligence technology is. To run this kind of a high-end technology, the platform should be very good. So in our equipments we have made a very strong platform with the CPU processing is 4 times faster as compared to the conventional CPU. The GPU graphical processing unit is 10 times faster than the normal conventional GPU, and definitely frame rate plays a very, very important role when we talk about these high-end technologies. So what benefit we are getting from artificial intelligence platform is it saves 80% of the keystrokes, which normally we use when we do the use the equipment. It saves a lot of our time. Almost 90% of time is saved with this, and it provides more than 95% of accuracy also when we are scanning on specific application. In artificial intelligence, we have introduced into multiple clinical applications, as you can see, as fetus, as MSK, as breast, as today's topic is the breast imaging, and as thyroid. Now, in this, we can see what artificial intelligence does. It reads the clinical images. For example, you can see on the left side of your screen, there is a breast lesion. So what equipment will do, with just a press of one button, equipment will identify this lesion, will trace the lesion, and will provide the required information on screen. Like, as you can see, what is the orientation of this lesion, how is the calcification, is that how are the margins of this lesion. So all this information will come on screen with touch of a button, which saves a lot of time, and it's a really handy tool which is really a future technology which is there. Same thing can be applied in thyroid also, where we can see all the information on screen with the touch of a button. In SMSK, it, as you can see, it will automatically identify the structures, will give the annotation on screen with touch of a button. So it saves a lot of time. In S-fetus, as obstetric scans we do, it has a big patient database where the machine reads these and it recognizes the ultrasound image, provide the information on screen. Our equipments are based on shared services platform. So all kind of applicable imaging, small parts and vascular, pediatric applications, OB-GYN, 3D-4D, cardiology, all those applications can be performed very, very easily. We have full range of ultrasound systems, as we have different series which are available. So as you can see on your screen, S series, where we have both standalone and portable with us. Then we have a P series, which is called as a premium series. There also we have multiple products catering different product segments. Point of care, we have a portable equipments also. We have X3 and X5, which caters like bedside scanning, ICU, OT scannings can be done very, very easily with these equipments. Then on a portable segment, we have a E series also, where these are the whole body color Doppler systems, can perform all kinds of applications. To support all those equipments, we have wide range of transducers also available with us. And all these transducers are having multi-frequency bandwidths. As today's topic is breast imaging, so we have a high frequency linear probe with 3 to 17 megahertz frequency bandwidth, and the footprint is also bigger, 50 mm footprint is there. Then same, simultaneously, we have a low frequency probes also with the standard footprint also. We have, for MSK, we have those hockey stick probes, and other transducers are also available for those kinds of specific applications. Just a glimpse of the grayscale resolution and the color pickup, what you can see on our wide range of ultrasound equipments. We have all kinds of advanced 3D-4D applications also, and you can see a glimpse of 3D-4D images also, which are coming here and can be done very, very easily on our all kinds of equipment. Sonoscape is really focused on after-sales support and application support. As we know that in ultrasound, it's very, very important that once the equipment is installed, application person has to come and do the optimization of the equipment and make the doctor comfortable with the equipment. So we have a fully trained application specialist, and after sales services, service engineers also are available, which can anytime be connected to you for any kind of a support required after installation. So here I conclude my presentation. Thank you so much for attending this webinar and not taking much time. I will directly hand over the session to Dr. Amal to take it forward. Thank you so much.
Good evening. Let me take this opportunity to welcome you all to the second session of the day. The topic is pregnancy-associated breast diseases. And our speaker for the day is none other than Dr. Janaki P. Dharmarajan. She's the clinical assistant professor at Amrita Institute of Medical Sciences, Kochi. And also she has done her fellowship in breast imaging from Canada. And over to you, Janaki, for this talk on pregnancy associated breast diseases.
Okay, thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you, sir, for the warm welcome. And I think recently I've been promoted as, I still put it as, I've become an associate professor. Actually, I've not updated it yet. And hearty thanks to the IRA as well as Sonoscape Breast webinar for allowing me. So today I'll be speaking on pregnancy-associated breast diseases. We'll be covering the definition, the physiology, imaging modalities. We'll see what is the classification of the disease and how to manage it. So pregnancy, when do we exactly term it as pregnancy-related breast diseases? When any lesion to the breast occurs during pregnancy, during the entire course of lactation, or even if the patient is not lactating, within 1 year postpartum. It is seen that about 80% of the palpable lumps during pregnancy and lactation have benign findings. And we need to have an understanding of the expected clinical and imaging findings associated with physiological breast changes that occur with common breast diseases for successful management of these conditions. So the changes unique to breast tissue occurs due to higher levels of circulating hormones, which leads to more ductal and lobular growth. There is increased vascularity and reduction in stroma. The fat and fibroblast tissue vary among women, but not between both breasts of the same woman. This you have to keep in mind. So whatever changes are occurring, usually they are symmetrical. So in the first trimester, we see the predominance of estrogen that leads to ductal proliferation and albumin. During the second and third trimester, progesterone comes into play that leads to lobular hyperplasia, invasion of fibrofatty stroma. After delivery and lactation, the placental estrogen and progesterone levels fall. So prolactin and oxytocin increase that leads to milk letdown. And we have to remember that the physiology manifests clinically with increased breast size, there is firmness, there is nodularity, and this persists throughout lactation. But all these changes baseline 3 months after cessation of lactation. So it is very essential to perform a thorough breast examination during the first obstetric visit, first trimester. On ultrasound, during pregnancy, usually we see the proliferative changes and they are usually hypolactation because of the milk content, which is echogenesis, appears the breast pad lactation. So basically what we see is an increased breast size and density. And these changes are more prominent within in the late third trimester as well as early lactation. So usually we have to make sure that the patient, we ask the patient to nurse the baby or pump the milk before mammography so as to reduce breast. And abdominal shield is to be used during pregnancy. MRI, like Dr. Rupa had already told, during pregnancy, but during lactation, we can do it. So the changes that are seen from a non-pregnant breast is, there is increase in T2 signal intensity, that is mainly due to the aqueous nature of the milk. And also there is, because of increased vascularity to the breast, there is increase in rapid diffuse enhancement. Now we come to the classification of diseases. Bloody nipple discharge is a unique condition that happens during lactation also. We can have infectious or inflammatory changes, benign breast lesions, and pregnancy-associated breast cancer. So bloody nipple discharge. Usually, whenever the patient encounters bilateral spontaneous discharge without any association, so especially during lactation, it can be quite frightening, but it may represent a totally harmless and self-limited condition that usually clears off 7 days. And this is basically because of unnoticed minimal trauma that results in a setting of epithelial proliferation and formation. So this is also called as rusty pipe syndrome. So usually what happens is, especially if the patient is expressing milk, she will say, oh, I got bloody nipple discharge. Sometimes the neonate may vomit out blood and that is how they come to recognize it. But basically, whenever it happens bilaterally without any masses, it's a totally harmless condition and we don't have to worry. This instance when we have to be really concerned is when it is a spontaneous unilateral bloody nipple discharge without any mass. In this instance, we have to breast mainly to evaluate the retroareolar ducts to exclude any papilloma or intraductal malignancy. And like Dr. Rupa had told, can be performed if it's a single duct discharge with suspicious cytology. So here we are, additional thing is suspicious cytology, but usually it's a very cumbersome procedure and we definitely don't advocate it. And MRE breast can be performed if mastitis is a clinical diagnosis. So in early ultrasound, early mastitis, there is regional thickening. And when it becomes focal, there is skin thickening. There can be a focal hypoechoic mass with regional hyperemia. And focal inflammatory masses may be present, mimic a solid mass. So we had a 30-year-old lady who had a one-month-old neonate with a tender left breast lump. And she did not have any response to therapy. So we did an ultrasound. So initially, there is diffuse skin thickening was noted. At 1 o'clock position, see a hypoechoic mass. It's not a mass, more of hypoechoic area was seen, but we could not see any mobile echoes. Increase in vascularity was noted, and she also had enlarged lymph nodes. So since she was not having responding to antibiotics, we had to get the tissue sample. So we proceeded with a core biopsy. It turned out to be chronic mastitis, and the culture grew. Culture was MRSA positive. So especially for breast abscess, the patient usually presents with a fluctuant mass with history of mastitis. And we have seen that 3 to 11% of the mastitis proceeds to abscess formation. When the abscess matures, it appears as a thick walled mass with posterior enhancement. There may or may not be internal gas and debris. So in these cases, we have to make sure that the clinic, there should be clinical, careful clinical as well as ultrasound evaluation, and follow-up is very, very essential. It is seen that especially whenever this abscess is managed conservatively, the scarring is less. And ultrasound-guided aspiration is recommended in case of breast abscess, especially for pain relief, and it also shortens the duration of the illness. And mammography has to be done in atypical and refractory cases. So, when is ultrasound-guided aspiration? We can do it with the IHAGOD 18 to 21 G needle whenever the collection is less than 3 centimeters size, or whenever there is a larger collection, we have to call in the interventional radiologist and ask them to put in an indwelling catheter. And after the abscess is drained, if it recurs, and again we can repeat the aspiration for the same reason, like it reduces the symptoms as well as decreases the duration of the illness. Along with that, we have to make sure that the patient is receiving antibiotic therapy and pain management. If an underlying suspicious mass is there, we have to proceed with core biopsy. And the main important thing is the patient can continue breastfeeding even after biopsy or procedure, because it reduces milk stasis, and thereby the likelihood of recurrent abscess is reduced. We had a 30-year-old lady, 2 months into lactating, who presented with a right breast mass. So even though this looks quite, it looks like a complex cyst, but here we are able to see some irregular margins. So the next step is we proceeded with a mammography just to make sure that there are no suspicious calcifications. The mammography was normal. Core biopsy was performed that showed a perilobular mastitis, and she also grew Staphylococcus aureus that was MRSA positive. This is a case that shows a lady with 2 months into lactation who was having recurrent abscess, and this is how it looks like. Next, we come to granulomatous mastitis. It's a rare chronic benign disease of unknown cause. There are no specific findings. It's basically a diagnosis of exclusion. So the clinical and radiological features may suggest inflammatory breast cancer or a breast abscess. We have seen that the tracking pattern of the collection is seen along the subcutaneous tissue in most of the cases, as in non-pregnant ladies. The axillary lymph nodes are enlarged in 15% of the cases. So in these cases, biopsy is a must, and we have to proceed with radiopathological concordance also once we are performing the biopsy. We had a 27-year-old lady who was second gravida. She was 21 weeks pregnant, who presented with a non-healing ulcer with abscess drainage. So we did a core biopsy for her. It turned out to be neutrophilic granulomatous mastitis. So there was some confusion regarding what has to be done. Like, she couldn't be given very high dose antibiotics also. They couldn't, because of the infection, because of the neutrophils, they couldn't put her on steroids too. So somehow they did Mantoux, and that was strongly positive for her. And this lady, actually, she was put on empirical AKT, and within 1 month, she gave a very good response, actually. This another lady which we encountered during pregnancy. She was a G2, 28-year-old female, 4 months pregnant. And this is an image of a biopsy-prone granulomatous mastitis. So there are no clear-cut rules regarding how to manage the granulomatous mastitis in case of non-pregnant women also. So now we come to benign breast masses. They are galactosele, fibroadenoma, and lactating adenomas. So galactosele is the most common benign breast lump. It mainly follows cessation of breastfeeding. In this case, the milk is stagnant. The ductal dilatation occurs. Sometimes it ruptures also. And there is extravasation of milk into the surrounding stroma. So usually there is history of decreased frequency of nursing before a galactosele becomes apparent. It can present as a mobile lump. Inflammation or necrosis may be present. It can be a simple or complicated cyst with posterior enhancement. It can present as a circumscribed, ovoid, anechoic, or hypoechoic lesion. There is variable appearance because of the presence of fat content, the lesion age. And ultrasound shows a round or oval mass with variable echogenicity, fat fluid level. There is wall thickening in case of chronic inflammation. However, we have to remember that even if it presents with a complex cystic appearance, intralesional vascularity should never be present. However, surrounding compressed parenchyma is usually vascular, and sometimes we see apparent vascularity because of the mobile content. Mammography when performed shows a pseudolipoma. So in that it it's because of the higher fat content and the lesion is radiolucent. It can appear as a mass with fat fluid level, especially on MLO view. And here the fat is lighter, so that will be position dependent. And it can present as a pseudohematoma also because the mammography does not differentiate lipid from liquid. So it just has a pseudohematoma appearance. Sometimes aspiration is both diagnostic as well as therapeutic. However, always we have to tell the patient that they can recur or become super infected. We had a 27-year-old lady nursing a 3-month-old infant. This was in 2014 December. So we did a core biopsy. We got cheesy material and we sent it for culture. So since it was quite large in size, IND was performed by the surgeons, and the final histopathology also document how a galactosis changes with time. Sometimes it's better to be like that, and it's very to resolve. Another 31-year-old lady who had stopped lactation 3 months ago, who had presented with a left breast lump. She had a family history of breast cancer, and since ultrasound was showing a suspicious lesion, we proceeded with a core biopsy. But what happened was immediately after the first pass, the lesion collapsed. So very confident, we were thinking, okay, it's a galactosyl. Anyway, the pathology came as benign lesion, and we kept her on follow-up, and even after 6 months, it was stable. Now we come to fibroadenomas that are the most common benign solid lesions. They present as painless firm mobile masses. The fibroadenomas arise in the TDLU, and they consist of both epithelial and stromal components. They present as new or enlarging palpable mass, and they can be either multiple and bilateral. They are expected to grow during pregnancy and lactation because they are hormone sensitive, and sometimes the previously undetected lump becomes prominent during pregnancy and lactation. They usually present as a hypoechoic mass with circumscribed, and they become less conspicuous during pregnancy due to proliferation of the isoechoic glandular tissue. Rapid growth in a fibroadenoma leads to complex features, and sometimes they can become tender and non-mobile. So in these cases, infarction has to be considered. And any atypical features on imaging or clinical examination necessitates a tissue biopsy. We had a 32-year-old lady, 2 months pregnant. She had a lesion, and we did a core biopsy, and that showed fibroadenoma. Another lady who was lactating with a lesion that was vascular, we did a core biopsy that showed myxoid fibroadenoma. So these lesions were just followed up, and they eventually regressed. So we have to remember that in a lactating patient who has a biopsy-proven fibroadenoma, up to 20% of the growth can be safely followed up instead of a biopsy. The same applies to previously biopsy-proven pregnant patients who show mild increase in size, but we have to do a meticulous follow-up to exclude malignancy. Coming to lactating adenoma, it's a benign stromal tumor, and it is histologically different from fibroadenoma in that they consist predominantly of the epithelial elements with very minimal stromal component. And they are present as palpable mobile masses that show rapid growth during pregnancy, can be hypoechoic solid masses with circumscribed margins, and they may have microlobulations. So it is seen that the epithelial component consists of the mature tubules that are similar to those found in normal tissue, and each microlobule of the acinus gets distended with the secretions, and that is what actually presents as a microlobulation. So in these cases, tissue biopsy is a must, and lactating adenomas usually regress after cessation of lactation. Because of the similarity to the normal tissue, adjacent tissue, even if you're getting a benign breast biopsy, that is concordant. We had a 29-year-old lady who was nursing a neonate, presented with a left breast mass. She, a non-guided biopsy, FNAC was performed actually because she refused a biopsy. It turned out to be benign epithelial proliferation with no atypia. So this lady was managed conservatively. Later on in 2017, she had presented for some lesion, and this is how that lesion has become now. So this just to show the progress of a lactating fibroadenoma. coming to pregnancy-associated breast cancer, it is concurrent with pregnancy or it occurs within 1 year of delivery. So if the patient is still lactating beyond 1 year, then it's a separate category called as lactation-associated breast cancer. It consists of 0.2 to 3.8% of all the breast cancers. This is common because more and more ladies are conceiving later in life. It presents as a painless mass or nodularity. And usually any mass that lasts for more than 2 to 4 weeks, imaging is essential. And it presents, there can be painless mass, unilateral enlargement of the skin, thickening can be there, localized pain might be there, nipple discharge, or the patients can sometimes present directly with metastasis. And usually we see incidence of milk rejection. That is, the infant is reluctant to suck milk from the affected breast. So when we ask the history, the patient says, oh yeah, the child was not feeding. So you, most of the pregnancy associated breast cancers are invasive mammary cancers with they're high grade with lymphovascular invasion. And they're mostly hormone positive. But 30% of the cases are also HER3 enriched. So, but the cases that we see are mostly triple negative. I don't know for what reason. And they usually present as a large tumor. They are later diagnosis and they have got worse prognosis. So delay in diagnosis can be attributed to the hypertrophy of the breast tissue that occurs during pregnancy and lactation, and that can mask symptoms. Ultrasound has got a high sensitivity and specificity with negative predictive value of almost 100%. Whenever suspicious lesion is there, we have to do a targeted ultrasound. We have to biopsy if it is suspicious. If it is malignant pathology, we have to do a second look ultrasound to see the contralateral breast as well as the same breast to look out for multifocality. Usually, in advanced stages, these masses have large cystic parts, and that is due to their invasive nature and central necrosis. The typical BI-RADS features may not be present. It is seen that features like spiculated margins, irregular shape, and non-parallel orientation are specific. But about 60% of the cases do have parallel orientation as well as posterior enhancement in case of pregnancy and lactation. So they can be quite misleading. So any suspicious features, we have to proceed with the biopsy. So in case it is a T3, that is more than 5 cm mass, or there is axillary lymph node involvement, we have to proceed with ultrasound abdomen to rule out hepatic metastasis. We had a 30-year-old female. She was 2 months postpartum. She presented with a more than 10 cm mass. So this is how it looks like, a nice big pregnancy. So we asked her, okay, what were you doing? She said, oh, I thought it might be just some collection. So she was not even aware that it was a solid mass. On mammography, like Dr. Rupa told, a mammography is a safe method with abdominal shielding, reduces radiation by further 50%. So the normal breast dose that mammography gives is about 3 milligray. For the fetus, it's only 0.03 milligray. But mammography is indicated only in clinical and imaging suspicious lesions or biopsy-proven malignant lesions. The sensitivity ranges from 78 to 90%. And mammography is good in detection of microcalcifications, the multifocal lesions, and multicentric lesions. And the imaging features of malignancy are similar to that of non-pregnant lesions. In addition to it, we also see increased skin thickening with increased parenchymal density, and that is a part of pregnancy as well as lactation. We had a 36-year-old lady with a right breast lump of 3 months duration, and she was nursing a 3-month-old new infant. And she has very recently stopped lactating. She had her FNAC was done from elsewhere, and that was suspicious for neoplasm. And this is what we did. Initially, we did an ultrasound. And what we found out was, because of the wide angle, we know it's a more than 5 cm mass. And her axillary lymph nodes were also looking suspicious. So since it was malignancy, we proceeded with mammography. So that showed there is a heterogeneous area of almost 8 cm in size. And on closer look, we are able to see clusters of pleomorphic calcifications within. So if you had not done a mammography, we would have never known about the calcifications. It's also got enlarged lymph nodes. And another change is, actually, if we see closely, the left breast is larger in size as compared to right. And it also shows prominent lactation changes. So probably this is a case of milk rejection from the right breast. So this lady, we did a biopsy that this also turned out to be a triple negative breast cancer, but the lymph nodes were reactive. Because of the large size of the lesion, she underwent NACT followed by a mastectomy with central lymph node biopsy. We had a 36-year-old lady, 2 days post-delivery, who presented with a right breast lump. We did an ultrasound, and this showed a complex solid cystic mass, but this solid portion showed vascularity. We could have interlesional vascularity was present. Anyway, we decided to proceed with a core biopsy, and that also showed a triple negative breast cancer with lactational changes, and her lymph nodes were negative. For MRI breast, contrast agents are not recommended during pregnancy because studies have shown that gadolinium crosses the placenta as it is some of it is contained in the amniotic fluid that is excreted by the fetus. So we're not sure of the toxic effects of free gadolinium on the fetus. It is indicated during lactation, especially in case of biopsy-proven neoplasm, to know the extent of the disease. And in these cases, breastfeeding should be performed before the scan, and it has to be withheld, or milk has to be expressed out for 24 hours post-scan. So the changes are like there will be rapid background pancamel enhancement may be there, or we can see the masses or non-mass enhancement, but other than that, there should not be any problem with the diagnosis. So we had a 36-year-old female who delivered 3 months ago, and she breastfed the baby for 2 months. She presented with a right breast mass that was found out to be a malignant mass, luminal B-type. She wanted breast conservation. So we did a mammography, we did an ultrasound. So ultrasound, even on mammography, it was a fairly well-defined lesion in a dense breast. Ultrasound was not able to show the extent of the lesion very well. We did an MRI. These are the T2-weighted images wherein I told you there is T2-weighted images are bright due to secretions. And this is a post-contrast image. So what we are seeing is actually a nice necrotic tumor. So even though it is luminal B, somehow it turned out to be quite necrotic. It's quite unusual actually. So I think most of the cases I'm showing seem to be quite unusual. Okay, so breast biopsy can be performed under ultrasound as well as mammography guidance during pregnancy as well as lactation. And MRI-guided biopsy can be performed safely during lactation. So because the local anesthesia is safe, there is always increased risk of bleeding and infection. And rarely milk fistula can form. However, this can be avoided if you are going with a peripheral approach, because milk fistulas are common, especially when we go with a central approach. So the take-home message is, most pregnant and lactating women presenting for breast imaging have benign breast disease. Thorough breast examination in the first adequate visit is a must. We have to evaluate all palpable masses that persist for more than 2 weeks or longer duration by ultrasound. We have to biopsy any new solid masses, even if they are benign. If no biopsy is performed, a close imaging and clinical follow-up is a must. Even if no abnormality is discovered in ultrasound or mammogram, biopsy should be performed from the region of persistent palpable nodularity or thickening. These are the references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Janaki. Now we'll take a few questions. One is, how long does galactosyl persist?
It can be actually during the mammography, screening mammography, we have seen galactosyls even in 70-year-olds also. So it can persist. So as long, it could be asymptomatic, it will be persistent.
Okay. Now, this is a question for both of you, but now that you're talking about pregnancy related, now this is in IVF pregnancy patients, often they have painful or lumpy breasts, possibly due to aggressive hormonal treatment. Now, is screening required based on their increasing age?
If the screening for what? Yeah, Rupa, you can answer.
Yeah.
If they fall into the category of like more than 40, if they are undergoing IVF and they are more than 40, then probably we can put her for a regular screening. Okay. But seeing that IVF patients, the history of IVF, we do see a lot of patients less than 50 having developing breast cancer.
Okay.
Yeah, that increases the risk of it.
I think Rupa, Dr. Balchandran has got a few more questions for you.
Okay, sir, I'll answer.
Sir?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I can hear.
Please come. There is one question from Jana Prakash.
Okay.
He says, please comment on role of thermography.
Thermography is still not FDA approved, so we don't use it for screening.
Okay. Most of the time, we do not pick lesions on that thermograph.
Yeah.
But we can also.
But not me. Maybe I think it's Amal sir. Yeah, sir.
Dr. Amal, if you can ask the question, I think there is some voice problem with Dr. Balachandran inside. So Dr. Amal can ask the question.
Yeah, most of the time we don't pick lesions on bad mammograms, but pick up on USG. So is it always necessary to do USG correlation with mammo?
So for screening, it doesn't apply because it is. We have to understand the fact that we cannot perform the whole breast screening handheld ultrasound.
Okay.
Targeted by ultrasound is what will help. If a patient presents clinical symptom and you don't find anything on a mammogram, and the next step would be targeted ultrasound.
Okay.
But if you have heterogeneous dense breast screening patient to find out whether she has got a cancer, we don't really need to perform an ultrasound. We have a good quality mammogram or a screening setup. It's up to us. If you are not confident enough to pass it off now, then I think many Indians are more comfortable with ultrasound rather than reading a mammogram. But if we don't find anything on a mammogram in a screening setup, we may not find anything very clinically relevant finding on ultrasound. The situation is different in a diagnostic setup. We find a negative mammogram for women with clinical symptom, definitely targeted ultrasound is required.
Okay.
Yeah, now, I'd like to add one more thing here, especially screening, and we have got tomosynthesis, so definitely the rate of second look ultrasound becomes very less because tomosynthesis just picks out even tiny ones like architectural distortion. So if tomo is normal, then really we don't have to go in for a second look ultrasound.
Exactly. And we should somehow practice the habit of reading the mammogram, interpreting it, and then analyze the lesion and then go and do a targeted ultrasound.
Yeah, it should be targeted ultrasound.
Yeah.
No need for screening ultrasound.
Yeah, somehow we are very comfortable doing the ultrasound as soon as we find a lesion on a mammogram. That
okay.
is.
Okay. Now, the other question is benign appearing lymph node, axillary lymph node without breast lesion. What BI-RADS will you assign?
It is a BI-RAD 1. It is a negative mammogram. Axilla is a nodal station. We do expect normal lymph nodes there, like we see it in the neck, like we see it in the inguinal area. So seeing a normal lymph node doesn't mean anything. It's not going to change the BI-RAD categorization.
Okay.
So we will report that as a negative BI-RADS 1.
Yeah.
Yeah. Even if you're finding abnormal lymph nodes, if it is bilateral, then the systemic disease has to be suspected. And it will be going as BI-RADS 2. But if it is a unilateral lesion, you have to examine the breast thoroughly once again. And biopsy may be indicated in the unilateral abnormal lymph node.
Is it Amal? You can unmute.
Janaki, this is about can we differentiate infected galactosele from abscess?
It may not infected. No, it may not be possible on imaging. So we need to aspirate and find out.
Okay. And next question is, I think any one of you can answer. Is mammography more about a lot of hype, except microcalcification? Is mammography useful for lesion characterization? I feel USG is much useful across all ages of patients. your opinion.
Hand-eye ultrasound is not accepted as a screening modality. And if you are in clinical practice, I'm sure every one of us who is in breast imaging practice would agree to that. If you find, I mean, finding a small 3 millimeter additional lesion which is going to change the management of the patient is actually many a times impossible to do, identify on the ultrasound in the first go, you know. But mammogram, it is much more clearer, and characterization of the lesion, especially with tomosynthesis, has become much more clearer. The margins, the architectural distortion, those calcifications, the extent of the DCIS along with invasive cancer, all that information can be obtained only with the mammogram. For example, if a lady presents with a hard mass, everyone can see with a nipple retraction, it is easier to know that it is a CA breast. We don't need imaging. Why do we need imaging? Imaging is to see whether this is only an invasive cancer or it is much more beyond that. That has a lot of information that we need to give from the surgeon's point of view. How are they going to manage? Are they going to do a breast conservation? Are they going to do a mastectomy? Is that the only lesion or is there an additional lesion? Is there an extent of DCIS which is extending from the lesion to how many distance? So all that information cannot be obtained with ultrasound. Yes, if there is a mass, maybe to characterize the mass, ultrasound may also can be done there, but there is much beyond that we need, we are actually looking into when it comes to the management of cancer.
Yeah, and also the general practice, I have seen that especially when only ultrasound of the breast has been done, I do get a report saying that, okay, there is a cyst at 1 o'clock, there is a cyst at 3 o'clock, there is a cyst at 7 o'clock. But what does this mean to the clinician? Because ultimately the way we report, it should be of some use for the clinician. They should know what is important is what we are describing, the recommendations, that is what is most important. So just describing all the lesions by ultrasound alone is not enough. How we are going to manage the lesions is what is most important. And actually, that is the essence of breast imaging.
True.
Okay. Now, Dr. Janaki, how frequently should we follow benign-looking lesions in pregnancy?
Yeah, 6 months follow-up, or we tell her if it increases in size, she has to come before that. That is especially if she is pregnant. But once she is delivering, for 1 year, we do like that. And after that, we tell her if it is still stable, that, okay, she can come 6 months after cessation of lactation. Because usually it takes at least 3 months for the changes to come back to baseline level. We give her another 3 months. So 6 months after stopping lactation. So once it is stable, then we don't have to follow up again.
Okay.
I would just like to add one more point. It is very important to the breast count that we tell the patient and also the referring gynecologist that if the lump increases, because we are not going to see her every month. The gynecologist is the one who is going to see the patient for antenatal care every month. So it is very important for the patient and also the gynecologist to palpate the lump and see if it is alarmingly increasing in size. She shouldn't be waiting for 6 months. So that information has to be passed on both to the patient and to the referring gynecologist. Because pregnancy
and also the recommendation, aggressively also growing. The recommendation so that it is official.
Yeah, very true.
Okay. How frequently we should evaluate acute mastitis to check if resolution occurred or abscess formed?
Yeah, usually whenever acute mastitis is there, so we give antibiotics for about 2 weeks. If it doesn't respond in 2 weeks or if some fluctuant, clinically fluctuation occurs, then ultrasound has to be performed. So usually if the patient is showing resolution in 2 weeks, we don't have to do anything. If it is not responding to antibiotics, or even before that, within 2 weeks, if it doesn't respond to antibiotics, or even if it becomes fluctuant within 2 weeks, we have to proceed with the ultrasound.
Okay. Are you practicing wires, hydromarks for solid lesion of breast?
So I didn't get the question.
Are you practicing wires? I mean, maybe for localization, wire localization. Hydromass, yeah, for solid lesion of breast.
What is the second part? Why are we doing? What is the second
one? Hydromass. Maybe it's hydro for water. Hydromass for solid lesions of breast.
Do they mean ultrasound? That clip placement?
Maybe, yes, yes.
The one which swells up or something? Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, yes. Could be that, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So, wires, usually, yeah, we do practice, especially in case of non-palpable lesions or for localization of calcifications. But I think right now the ultrasound that is not available in India as of now. In the past 3 or 4 months, they have not been available. So in case if they are available somewhere, I will be happy to know the address from where to get them.
Okay, now role of elastography in solid breast lesions.
Dupa, you take that.
Yeah. Elastography actually increases the specificity, but what we rely upon is still the morphological feature of the lesion. Say, for example, if the lesion is morphologically suspicious, just because the elastography is soft doesn't mean anything to us. We are still going to go ahead and biopsy. Yes, it does increase the specificity. It does increase the confidence in us to say that it is benign or it is malignant. But isolated elastography findings will not be taken for decision of management or is not going to change the recommendation. It's always been interpreted along with the grayscale findings, which is the morphology, the size, the shape and the margins definitely takes higher importance than the elastography findings, but we do consider.
Okay. Next question is, how do we differentiate between granulomatous lesion from malignant lesion?
In case of granulomatous mastitis, what we have observed is usually it occurs post-delivery, means and within 6 years of delivery. So this is one of the histories. So mostly young ladies who have delivered about within 6 years, they do have. And if any sinus formation is present, that leads more to a diagnosis of granulomatous mastitis. But whatever be the thing, we need to have a tissue biopsy because it's seen that in 15% of the granulomatous mastitis, the lymph nodes are enlarged. So we need to have a tissue diagnosis. And especially while doing the biopsy, if you're getting some abscess, so we have to send it for culture sensitivity as well as for AFB. Either it can be for smear or it can be for gene expert. So while doing the biopsy, sir, we'll have an idea. And in granulomatous mastitis, what I observed is the typical tracking pattern along the subcutaneous tissue that is very, very pathognomonic in case of granulomatous mastitis. It can occur in case of inflammatory breast cancers also, but then there are other features. So it's not an isolated feature. We have to consider everything in toto, but ultimately we need to biopsy and that is the one which will give us the final diagnosis.
There is a related question regarding experience with breast tuberculosis.
Yeah, actually, it is different in different centers. So, like in our center itself, there are 3 surgeons who are practicing different regimens. So, one of the surgeons, they just, but without tissue biopsy, we are not putting the patient on AKT. So, that we are following uniformly because the hepatic toxicity is much more severe to manage. But like the one case which I showed, that lady was pregnant and her Mantu was very strongly positive. She was having some strong family history also. So in this case, since she was not responding to anything, we empirically had to start. So 2 or 3 cases we have started, we have got good response. But frankly, now almost 100 cases of granulomatous that I have done the biopsy and have sent for gene expert or AFB, only one has grown mycobacteria, the cornibacterium. This is atypical mycobacteria. But I have not got any positive tuberculosis in any of the samples that I have done so far. Rupa, what about yours?
Yeah, I totally agree. We all in our setup also, we don't empirically start the patient on ATT. If it is a granulomatous mastitis and if the TB culture gene expert is negative, we don't start them on ATT. I think it's very important. Just because tuberculosis is endemic in our country doesn't mean that all granulomatous mastitis are tuberculous mastitis. So we should not give her unnecessary side effect by starting an ATT empirically without a diagnosis. I totally agree with you, Janaki.
Now, Rupa,
yes,
what is the role of MRI in postmenopausal women?
It is a very postmenopausal women. I'm not able to understand the question in what setup, in screening, in diagnostic.
So
MRI is not an investigation of choice for a low risk for a lady in general population. It's not an accepted screening modality. Breast cancer, if the lady is under low risk, whether she's 40, 50, premenopausal or postmenopausal.
because MRI is a very highly sensitive modality. It will pick up lot of false positives. So we'll end up, we can't be biopsying her all the findings. So it has to be judiciously used only for high risk screening and for select intermediate risk screening.
Only thing is, in case of postmenopausal women, like we don't have to time the scan. Like premenopausal, perimenopausal has to be according to the menstrual cycle. For postmenopausal, we don't need. It's almost a walk-in that we can do.
Exactly. Other than that, I don't see any. Because she's postmenopausal, it doesn't sound like we're going to put her for MRI instead of MAM.
That's most true.
The gold standard.
Indications won't change.
Okay. Now, there was a question on Dr. Rupa.
Yes, sir.
This regarding, could you explain those risk stratification once again? Low, intermediate, and high.
Okay, low risk is less than 15%. That means the lady is not having any personal history of breast cancer, any pre-malignant or high-risk lesions prior. There is no family history. This is a rough estimate, but basically we need to get all the information and feed it into the models, and then it actually stratifies the risk. But I'm telling you in a broad perspective, an intermediate risk are those group of women who carry those pre-malignant high-risk lesions and who have got a family history of or a personal history of breast cancer. The high-risk group, which is more than 20% lifetime risk, are those genetic carriers, like, for example, the BRCA mutation, the Cowden syndrome, and all those syndromic associations and genetic mutations come under high risk. And if the woman has got a history of radiation between the age of 10 to 30 on her chest, again, she comes under a high risk. So these are, and if the family history is a first degree family history with known BRCA mutation or with unknown, with the genetic analysis has not been done for the first degree relative, but they have a bilateral breast cancer or a young breast cancer less than 40, we still consider that those first degree relatives may be BRCA carriers, and then we evaluate them for further analysis. So all these group come under high risk, but this is roughly a broad classification. But we have to, there are some models wherein we can feed in all those clinical information that we obtain from the patient, and it calculates the risk for us. It stratifies the risk.
Now there's a general question on AI in breast lesions. One of you can comment on that.
Janaki, you want to take it?
Usually, the more experienced you are, the more you feel like challenging AI. So to convince the old timers.
Yeah, in certain Western countries, the screening mammogram is done with two readers. It's double reading. So there are certain countries which have implemented AI as a second reader. Still, we have to wait some more development for us to totally replace it in reading mammograms.
And for ultrasound also in Western setup, it is being done by the sonologist, not by the radiologist. So because the radiologist has so much in demand, so they don't have time to go and do the ultrasound. So it's being done by the sonologist, but they do it in a very professional way. They're trained in that. So when it's being done by these people, especially for screening ultrasound in case of dense breast, it may be definitely useful.
Okay. Now that there are no further questions, I think we can wind up this session. So thank you, Dr. Rupa. Thank you, Dr. Janaki, for the excellent sessions. Thank you, Sonoscape, for arranging this. Gaurav, special thanks to you.
Thank you, sir. Special thank you, ma'am. You.
And again, on behalf of IRA Kochi, Crest Kochi, and Sonoscape, we thank all those who have participated enthusiastically in this. And thank you for all those questions as well. Thank you all. Good night.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you so much. So there were around close to 900 doctors who were actually watching the lectures live. So I like to thank you, IRIA, Kochi Crest, Dr. Janaki and Dr. Rupa, Dr. Balachandran and Dr. Amal. Thank you so much for being so supportive and conducting this webinar. Thank you so much. I think we should conclude this.
Yes, yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you.